Louis Bloom here in the Wally Park studio in Glendora, California. I am joined by the two-time NHRA Heritage Series Top Fuel Champion, AA Fuel Dragster Champion, Mendy Fried. Mendy, how does that sound? Two-time champion.
It does not get old. It does not get old. And in fact, it just became two-time last week. So, you know, keep it coming. I don't mind.
You like the sound of that.
I do. Now, it sounds amazing.
Now, back-to-back championships, too. That's really the impressive part.
Well, it's a testament to the car, you know, obviously. The driver can't make the car go faster. My crew is amazing. And Tom Shelar, my crew chief just had it flat figured out. You know, he had been doing it for over 20 years and just picked away at it until got it right? And like he said, he wants to make those guys scratch their nuts to try and figure out what we're doing. So I think that he accomplished that.
Yeah, definitely this year and last year, the way your car dominated the series. Now, how many races is your series typically each year? Six races.
Yeah. So the bookends are Bakersfield with the March meet and the California Hot Rod Reunion. And then the next race on the series is Bowling Green, Kentucky. That's steeped in a lot of tradition as well. And then Boise, Idaho. And then Spokane was added this year. And then we went to Tulsa and we clinched the championship at Tulsa. And now we're going to the Hot Rod Reunion with our sights on winning that race.
You want to close out with a win?
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's an event that is just really a lot of fun to attend. There's so much going on. You know, sometimes I go there and I actually never watch cars going down the racetrack because there's so much in the pits to see. And then sometimes I just sit in the grandstands.
I know. It's a great event. It's a great event, yeah. There's a car show. There's a swap meet. There's the Cackle Fest. And then there's also the induction into the Hall of Fame on Friday at the DoubleTree Hotel. So there is a lot going on.
Is it the social event of the season?
I think you could call it that. Yeah, and it ends the season, which is nice.
What I love is, you know, John Force will show up, Robert Height, Jack Beckman.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen, you know, Ron Capps is like a diehard
fan.
Oh,
he usually has a ride.
Yeah.
Yeah, he usually has a ride in some nostalgia funny car.
Or a fuel altered. He really likes those fuel alters.
He does.
He's into it. You know, I've seen, Don Prudhomme walks around, just, you know, just takes the whole thing in.
It's nice because it's in between the pro races and it's just leading up to Pomona. So most people are in town, or if not, they come into town for that. So, yeah, there's a lot of stargazing there.
Yeah, Ed the Ace McCulloch's always in the house walking
around.
He's always
in the house. And
Roland
he's going
Leon.
Again this year.
That's
know?
Good.
And Roland will be there.
Some of the folks that you grew up watching, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And have had, the good fortune to work with, too, like Roland.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Now, let's talk about the fact that it's kind of bittersweet this year. Tom Shelar, you know, surprised everybody, passed away about a month ago.
He was end of August.
He was 59 years old, you know, and just really, really shocking.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a real gut punch, I got to say, you know. Tom is, I promised myself I would not cry today, but Tom just was a force, right? Like, and so fun too, you know what I mean? Our pit had an energy that was intoxicating and vibrant, you know? And I mean, the only thing louder than our music in the pits was Tom's laugh.
He had a great laugh, yeah.
So yeah, we're really, you know, struggling emotionally, but we made a decision that we're going to finish the season, and we went to Tulsa without him, and Sean Bellemere stepped up to be co-crew chief with Troy Green, who also is a longtime member of our team. Troy drove this car in 2008 when they won the championship, so I was in good hands. Yeah, I was in good hands.
Now, Tom really gave you the tools to have a championship-winning race car. You said that before. And the fact that his legacy lives on, that's a good thing.
Well, he gave me my first shot in one of these. It was in when they had a two-car team with Frank Rootbeer Hedge. The Master Cam car was the car that I drove. And so in 2004, I started with this team and you know, in 2017, I got invited to join it again. So, Tom changed my life, you know, twice. He gave me my shot and he made me a champion.
What was that phone call like from Tom, you know, before the 2017 season, asking you to drive the car?
It was amazing. I mean, we had been kind of talking, and then once he said, hey, why don't you come down to the shop, right? So all the guys were down at the shop that night, and they're all people I know. I mean, a lot of them I've raced with in the past, right? But it was still weird coming in, because it was just like, I think I have the ride. I'm pretty sure I have the ride, but am I auditioning a little bit? I don't think so, right? So we're just standing around, and about an hour goes by, and then, you know, I stand up on a crate, and I'm about to get into the car, you know, like just to kind of try it on, right? And I just like scream at the top of my lungs, I'm so excited! And I just yelled as loud as I could, right? And everybody like totally cracked up. And so from then on, it felt real. You know what I mean? It still didn't feel real for that first hour, but.
What was it like the first time you drove the car in competition?
Yeah, I've never driven one of these things as stout as this. You know, I've driven quite a few of them, but it got my attention, you know, definitely. And you know, the first run, it knocked the butterflies off, you know, knocked the rust off the driver because I hadn't driven anything in a while. And, a year or two, you know, and so it's exhilarating. You get out and you just kind of like, all right, this is really real, because I always say it's all BS until you're actually going down the racetrack in the race car, right? Everything else is just crap, you know? So you get out, it's like, okay, this is a real thing. This is actually happening. And, but it still took, you know, the next thing that struck me so obviously is that this car is so consistent and it repeats and repeats, right? And so you can actually come back and know what it did, because it does the same thing but different every time, as opposed to it just doing something stupid every time, you know, and then every now and then making a good run. So that was what struck me the most at the beginning.
And it's a fast car, which, you know, we'll see that in a little bit with some of the videos, that it is the quickest car of all time.
It's the fastest. It's the quickest, yeah, in history.
That's quite a statement when you think about the history of front motor top fuel cars going back to the beginning of drag racing, right?
Yeah, I mean, we're the first one to run in the 40s. So that's, I'm pretty proud of that.
Yeah, that's something to put on the mantle, you know, first in the 540s.
I know.
It's pretty awesome. Now, your first impression of drag racing, I know that was with your dad. Where did that happen? And why were you so blown away? Do you remember that?
I don't remember my first drag race, you know.
You were young, right?
I think that I was still a baby. So, one of the most lasting impressions was actually when we were running at the 1975 Winter Nationals. I think it was the Winter Nationals. And that was the first year where alcohol dragsters were allowed in Pro Comp, right? And John Shoemaker was driving the Renegade car that my dad was the crew chief for. And we made it to the final against Don Henriquez. Don Henriquez beat us.
One of the greats.
I know. And that actually was on TV, but that was my first trip to Pomona, and I think my first national event, because we were Northern California folks, right? We didn't have any national events up there.
So how old were you then?
Five.
Five, wow.
Yeah.
So that left an impression.
That left an impression, yeah. And then the funny thing is that in 1995, there was this series in the National Dragster, because it was the 50th anniversary, right? Was that?
The 50th anniversary was 2001.
2001? Okay, yeah. 2001. But they showcased a great race and an interesting race, and they showcased that race.
Oh,
and
wow.
I was on a plane going down to Cabo, and I open up this National Dragster. I'm just like, I was there, you know. I'm trying to tell the person next to me because I was by myself, and they were just like looking at me like, whatever. Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Sounds like the work of Brad Littlefield, that article.
It probably was the work of Brad Littlefield, yes.
When you think about that one now, let's talk about the fact that you worked, you know, working on race cars, building mm-hmm. race cars, bodies. You know, that was your day job when you were young.
Yeah, so I grew up working in my dad's chassis shop, and so I think that I started working with aluminum around like age 14 or 15, and so by the time I was graduating from high school, like he no longer had a tin guy; it was me. You know, so I built all the race car bodies and the seats and fuel tanks and stuff like that, and then. When I was 20, I moved to San Diego and did the same thing for Bob Meyer down there until like I was 21, and I, you know, I realized like I really should go to college, you know. So, which was like the smartest thing I ever did.
That was a good move then.
Yeah, that's a good move. That's a good move. But yeah, so that's what I started out doing, and as soon as I was old enough to drive, when I was not old enough to get my license, I made my license passes in a BE Econo Dragster that my dad built for Amos Beard that he loaned us when, and I was taller than him at 16, so I was shoehorned into this car. And when I was going to get my license, and Cloy Fitzgerald was reviewing the license paperwork, he was division director at the time. And he got to my age, which I left blank, and I also left my birthday blank, and he's just like, screw it. And he just went ahead and signed off on it. And so I sent that in the mail, and then I got my California driver's license on my 16th birthday, and I got my NHRA competition license in the mail 2 days later, and then raced that weekend at a division event in Sears Point.
A two for one,
yeah.
So you got your driver's license and your competition license in the same couple days.
In the same couple days, yeah.
You had it all planned out.
You were
going to drive a race
car.
I'm an
accountant.
Yeah, that's right.
I plan things.
You plan things, even back then when you were a teenager.
Right.
Well, it worked out pretty well, the accounting part. You were very successful in that field. And
it pays the bills.
Yeah, it pays the bills. But, you know, I mean, you made that decision that you wanted to, you know, get a real job. You could have tried to live that life of, you know, working in a race car shop, maybe getting a chance to drive a race car full time. But you made that decision that you knew you needed to have some, you know, steady form of income.
I'm not saying that like I was prescient enough to like see it coming, but I had tried to make it as a professional racer, a driver, and almost did and didn't, and then, you know, was trying to like reinvent myself, really. I mean, my father passed away in 1995. This is before then, obviously, but I was just trying to figure it out. I didn't have a ride, and I was like, I really should do something right now in this time to secure some sort of future in case drag racing isn't it, even though I thought it would be. And I'm really happy it went the way it went, right? Because now I get to do this. Not as my livelihood, but I get to do it. I get to choose to do it. It's like I don't have to do it to put, you know, food on the table.
It's your passion.
It's my passion. Yeah.
That's really what it's all about, your passion.
It must be, because it takes a lot of time and it's crushingly humbling, you know. So I get out of the race car sometimes just like, damn it, you know, like, because I'm definitely the weak link in this car, I think, you know, compared. Well, I mean, it's the best car in the country, you know, so.
So where does the competitive spirit come from?
Oh, God, it had to be from my dad, you know, absolutely. He and I would compete at things all the time. Even just a little game of Frisbee was, you know, was competitive. So definitely him.
All right, now, you know, this question is kind of obvious. I pretty much know the answer, but, you know, driving a top fuel car, funny car, you know, big show. We at the nostalgia races, you call them big show cars.
Right.
But has that ever come up?
Don't call them that?
Well, not when I'm in a national event. I just call them top fuel and funny car. But
sure.
When I'm at Bakersfield at a reunion or the March meet, I'm like, oh yeah, big show cars, because people come up to me and talk about the big show cars.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm.
Have you had a chance to look into that or want to do that, or is that something? Now, I kind of know the answer to this, but mm-hmm. I think our people watching would want to hear what you have to say about that.
You know, I think that the time when I would have wanted it for my profession has passed.
Okay.
Right? I think I absolutely would love to step on a loud pedal of one of those things, especially a funny car, and see what that feels like, you know. And so I would not say no to that. But as far as trying to pursue it as a career, I'm really not interested in doing that. And, you know, I did make a choice between, like, I would rather pursue a championship in front engine top fuel than run a car that's not going to have a shot at a championship in the big show, right? It's because I don't want to. It is a way to do it. I mean, I just don't. It would have to be all in, right, or nothing. I don't want to go to like six races a year when there's so many more, and like and not have a shot of going rounds unless the other guy screws up, right? But that being said, hell yeah, I'd get in one. I'd make some passes in one, definitely.
It goes back to being competitive, what you just said. You want to run for a championship and not just make runs.
Well, I've been and also ran for a while, right? Even in this, I've had some successful rides and I've had some very unsuccessful rides. And yeah, it's not a lot of fun when you don't have a shot at all, right? I mean, it just kind of kills your spirit a little bit. And telling people, hey, come see me race. Well, maybe not. Well, if you do, come Friday or Saturday so you'll at least see me make one run, you know, as opposed to now I tell people, come on Sunday, you know?
Yeah.
Might get in the winner's circle picture.
Now, speaking of big show, are there any big show drivers that you follow, admire?
Well, I admire any of them that have reached that level and, you know, have made it, that are good at it, one, and that realize or maintain a level of humility, right? I don't have much time for people that think it's all about them, right? And I think that some people get that in their head, you know, and so those are the people that I don't admire. Not that I'm going to name names, but sure. Yeah, I admire anybody that, I mean, it takes a lot. It takes a lot to get there. You know, I admire Ron Capps a bunch. I mean, I grew up with him, you know,
yeah.
So.
I think he admires you too.
Okay, cool.
I think so.
Cool.
Especially driving the car you drive.
Yeah.
Mr. Fuel Altered.
Mr. Fuel Altered. I know. He's always in a nostalgia funny car or Fuel Altered out there. We said that already, didn't we?
That's okay.
Yeah.
The beauty of this studio format, we could just repeat it.
We can repeat it. yeah. So, I actually do admire the low buck guys a lot, right? Just because it's so hard, you know, and it's gotta be tough when you're kind of racing to qualify, you know, and that sometimes even qualifying, I think they pay money for, you know, 18 spots total, right?
So they actually pay now to 20.
Yeah. So like, it just sucks when like the goal is to get money, but like not have to run first round, you know. And I know some people that's the goal, you know. But I still admire that. I mean, it's hard. Like Mike Salinas too. God, I got a lot of respect for him, you know.
You've watched him for longer than most of us, right?
Yeah, yeah. And he's so nice. His whole family's so nice.
And then they have a bright future in drag racing, his daughters, you know. I mean,
they're tearing it up.
I could see a couple top fuel cars, a couple A fuel cars plus the bike, and
Maybe
even a pro mod car someday. They're into it. Hopefully they're enjoying themselves.
And they are, right? And that's cool. And yeah, and the other one that I really enjoy is Scott Palmer. Oh man, you know, I'm so happy for him. He's doing so well, and it's his absolute passion. And he was one of those guys that, you know, would rarely qualify, or if he did, he's probably going out first round. And he made it into the top 10 last year, and I think he just missed the top 10 this year. But I pay attention to what he's doing.
Guy's got a blown nitro-burning Studebaker.
I know.
I mean,
it's so great.
How cool is that?
That dude is a racer, man.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Well,
racer.
Well said. Speaking of racing, let's check out some of your video. First up, your March meet win from 2017. You could take us through this.
Yeah, this is the first race that I drove this car.
Who's the guy talking in the background? You hear that sexy voice?
Yeah. That's my husband, Colton.
And that was a by run because your competition broke, right?
Yeah, Jim Murphy broke on the burnout. And, you know, we had struggled so much at this race. We actually blew the clutch up. We sheared an input shaft. and just became fireworks inside the car with me. Right now, like here, when I pulled up, I got the car stopped and I burst into tears. There was nobody up there. And I just sat in the car and cried my eyes out for a couple minutes. It took so much to get there.
It took so long to get here.
See, that's what I said. It took so long to get here.
It sounds like Whit Bazemore's voice there,
see,
too.
So really, my second full pass in the car felt like it hauled ass to me.
He asked me what to run.
That thing sounded like it was going through the lights at like 10,500 RPM.
It was 10,
so we'll see what kind of computer I have on board.
It's pretty close.
Yeah.
There you go.
It was amazing. It was such a struggle that weekend. And they've never won the March meet. And so it was the first March meet win for the team, too.
And for you, a student of the front motor top fuel car, mm-hmm. you know, that's a very historic race. U.S. Fuel and Gas Championships. I mean, all the legends have won the March meet. Prudhomme, Garlitz, Shirley, the Surfers.
Yeah, the Surfers, Mike Sorokin, Art Chrisman, my personal favorite.
Your favorite.
Yeah.
That was a big deal. Yeah. So that was the March meet win. Next up is your championship from the Hot Rod Reunion. And this is the final round. This is when you won the race, actually. Who are you taking on there?
Rick McGee in the Overtime Special. They call it the Overtime Special because they're all blue collar and they have to work overtime to be able to afford it. And yeah, we laid down a 561 on that pass, just like we knew what we were doing. And we had actually clinched the championship before this race because Tulsa rained out. And so we were mathematically the champions after that. But we did want to come here and kick everybody's ass at this thing. So that's what we do.
I like that helmet, by the way.
Yeah, Eric Reyes is the best. I sent it to him. I didn't even get any input. He just said, I got it, and sent that back to me.
I just love that race car of yours.
It's the baddest.
Yeah, it's cool. It's an amazing looking car.
I know. I mean, the thing that's so great too is we've all known each other for so long in this class. I mean, Rick McGee signed my license, you know, for this class. And so everyone was really happy for me too when I finally got a good ride, you know, because I've been trying. It took me 14 years to get a ride that was competitive like that.
It's a long trip. 14 years.
Yeah, I got discouraged along the way a couple times. I mean, sometimes I didn't even have a ride, so I would just crew for somebody. And I crewed for Denver Schutz and Jim Cullen for a couple of years.
You like getting your hands dirty. You like working on the car.
I cannot go to the races with nothing to do.
I just can't.
No. I'll just have to stay home and watch it from, like, you know, bank shift or something. Like, I just can't. I'll be bored. I have beers by noon, you know. Yeah. I just can't do it.
You have, you know, what I would say, incredible mechanical skills. And I'm not saying for a woman, because that's not the story. It's just that, you know, you know what you're doing. I've seen your, you know, shop at home. I know you're, you know, you like building things.
Yeah.
So that kind of plays out into the race car.
It does. And I think that if you know mechanically what's going on with the car, I think that you can bring better feedback back to your crew chief and your crew and tell them what's going on. I mean, it does happen pretty quickly, but I feel like I'm at an advantage because I know those things. And it's what I enjoy, right? I like to know why it ran the way it ran. I'd like to know what it tore up, if anything. I want to know what the decisions are that we're doing. I don't want to make the decisions, but I want to know what they are, right? So that I further my knowledge on that.
Next up is the quickest run of all time from the March meet, the 549 pass. And there's Tom on the right side there getting things ready before the run. I love the sound of the engine right here.
So up until this point, actually, this was after we broke the record with a 551 and then came back. This is the semis. And oh boy, I'm just going to warn you right now. I mean, Brett Williamson drills me horribly.
There's the in-car and Brett.
It was still, I'm not sure why. But we were having an issue with the throttle cable. We actually had to change it after this run.
Gotta love a racetrack with a Ferris wheel.
I know, that's the first time ever. So, it's just, even, he had such an advantage off the starting line and Thank God we ran what we ran. Because, and get in your own lane, Brett. Jeez, come on.
Look at Tom, right?
He's so happy. Look at him.
Wow. Now watch at the end when you go by at the last second here. Goodbye.
See ya. Bye-bye.
I can't Woo-hoo! Even imagine driving one of those cars.
Amazing.
That's how it is. Amazing.
I just need someone to be able to leave the starting line on time, but you know, with times like that, they're covering me for a while. Amazing.
Amazing.
So cool. Amazing. Yeah. There's no other word for it, you no. know? Like, God.
To be the first to do something in drag racing in any barrier, I mean, it's truly an honor. It's amazing. It's what it is. Next up, the championship race at Tulsa. You pretty much locked up the championship. This, I believe, is the final round. This is without Tom. So this is a very emotional win for your team.
It was rough, yeah. And you see, here's Sean Bellemere and Troy Green waiting for the results there. And so that was, we dug deep, I'm telling you. You know, we went there without him. And, you know, he taught us our jobs really well. Right? We just had to not screw it up, and we sure didn't. We did our jobs well.
You beat Adam Sorokin in the final round?
Yep. His Leahy device went off on the run, and he had a 4:17 reaction time against me. I had like a 70, and so he had quite a bit in the bank on me, but But
you
he
said,
would it.
You said 4:17 light the old days.
I know.
You were so old school. It's a 17 light now.
Whatever. It's a 4:17 light. And he was ahead of me at half track, and then his Leahy device went off. But he didn't have he'd have to run a 66 to beat me. And he hasn't seen a 70 run this year, so.
You had him covered.
Yeah. We still would have beat him. Yeah.
Our last video, you know, sometimes, you know, you take a risk out there. And sometimes things don't go according to plan. This is when you went off the track at, I believe, the Hot Rod Reunion, right?
This was a horrible weekend for us, yeah, this is the March meet.
March meet,
this is the March meet this year. It shakes so bad on this run that it rips the rear end out of the car.
See? Yeah, that's crazy tire shake right there.
Crazy tire shake. And so it ripped the rear end out of the car, and it took the brakes with it. And so I was only on the gas for, you know, a second. So I don't even get on. I don't get on the brakes until I'm pulling the brakes. And I pull the fuel shot off in the lights, and then I realize I don't have any brakes. And I mean, no brakes. So I'm cruising past the shut offs. You know, I'm going by one. I'm probably only going like 30 miles an hour. I go by another one. And I'm probably only going like 15 miles an hour. But it was just too big of a risk to make the turn. Like, I was so tempted, but wow, I'd feel like an idiot if I flipped it, right?
Yeah.
So here I go, off the end of the track. And
that's a long shut off.
It's a long shut off, but when you have no brakes, there's nothing to do.
Now you're buried in the sand. Now this is the best part, the reaction when you get out of the car. You're undoing your belts.
You should have heard what I was saying in my helmet. Yeah, it was just, and you know, we had blown the blower off the run before. So luckily, we were in the show when we did that, because we never made a full pass. You know, and I think we were number 8 qualifier. I think. Oof. Yeah, I'm pretty pissed. Yeah.
Watch this moment. Watch the moment right here when you take your helmet off. Taking off the old Hans device.
I'm so mad.
Is it hard to watch this or?
No,
kind of over
no,
at this point.
It's funny, actually. It's a reminder, like, the cameras are always rolling.
There you go. Wow. You're like, this is not good.
This is not good. This is not, well, okay, so full disclosure, I had a concussion at the time because I had a really bad blower explosion testing 2 weeks before, and then another blower explosion, and then this tire shake was not helping my head. And I didn't go to the doctor because I knew the doctor would tell me I couldn't drive the race car. So I went to the doctor
just,
the day after.
I'm just going to take the fifth on this one. Just ignore it.
I was pretty pissed because my head hurt pretty bad. And I really just wanted to, like, take care of it. And nothing was happening that was taking care of it, you know.
Just a bad weekend.
Up until that point, yeah. I mean, And then we, on our first full pass, we ran the 51, which broke the record. And then on the next pass, we ran the 49, which broke the record.
And it all changed.
It all changed. And then you know, I stepped on the gas in the final and car didn't move.
Yeah.
Because throttle linkage fell off. So, yeah, it was just a comedy of errors that weekend.
But you still broke the record and got the 40 pass.
Yeah.
All right. Now, one thing, I've luckily enough been to your house. You know, we're actually friends and I socialize with you and your husband. And what I love is that, you know, there's a lot of great art hanging on the wall. But the thing I really dig is that there's always some vintage copies of drag racing magazines.
No, of
which
course.
Are like strewn, you know, on
all
the coffee
over the
table.
Place. Yeah.
And, you know, I'll pick up a 1971 issue of Drag Racer, you know, Drag Racing USA or something. And I just love the fact now, when you're home, do you ever like just sometimes go like, wow, we're really in this. You know, this is our life.
Yeah, well, when Cole and I started dating, the first time I went to his house, I guess I was the only one to ever reach for one of those. And so he comes in the room and I'm reading, I don't remember which one it was right now, but it's Don Garlitz on the cover.
Oh, with the Donovan motor?
Yes.
Nice.
With the Donovan
hot rod.
Motor. Yes,
it was
hot rod. And so I'm reading this and he walks in and he's just like, okay, this is something that has to be dealt with. You know? Because I'm the only one that's ever reached for one of those. I'm like, what? You know? What are you talking, what? What's... Okay.
That should have been like, you know, right there. It was like done deal.
Right?
We're meant for each other.
Apparently we are because
exactly.
That's what happened. We're going down the road together.
Now, one thing I want to show you, this is from my collection at home. One of these great little die-cast cars. This is the California Charger of Keeling and Clayton. So what, if anything, relates to your car compared to a 1960s, early 70s top fuel car?
Oh, so much.
Got to hold it up to the camera there. There you go. Nice job.
So much. But then they're so different as well, right? I mean, I'm sure mine's a longer wheelbase. I have 225-inch wheelbase. But the basic configuration, obviously, the engine in front is the same. I have a 417 Donovan. This is probably a steel 396 in here, right? But only one magneto and only, you know, in a small roots blower. This is a 671, I'm sure. Ours is a 671. Then those are the rules of the class. Like, it's meant to be limited, so it limits the performance. We have tiny tires. You know, now they're 11 inches wide, but they used to be only 10, which was cray-cray. And you know, the bell housing in this one is not as safe as mine.
Yeah, that's for sure.
I tested mine at the March meet. And if this one had done that, it might have cut the car in half. And my scoop is similar to this. My scoop is actually modeled off the Surfer scoop.
Nice.
So, which this one has a little bit of a peak, so it's a little different. But.
When you look at that car and you think about the fact that you basically drive something that replicates that part of history in drag racing, what does that mean to you?
Well, you know what? I mean, these guys were nuts. You know what I mean? They were nuts. And I told Dale Pulte that one time. I'm like, these guys were crazy. I was cackling the 204 car, Caramassini's car. And I mean, you can see the ground. It's like, look at it's mild steel pipe that's like, looks like it came out of somebody's plumbing, you know? And he said, well, it's, what you guys do is nuts too, right? It's so much quicker and faster. Like, we didn't get the memo that the engine shouldn't be in front. Like, these guys got the memo in the 70s and put it behind them, right?
Yep.
So, but I feel a little bit of like, you know, kindred spirit with them, you know, but so.
So what'd you bring for show and tell?
Oh,
this is the best part, by the way.
This is the best part?
Yeah, I like show and tell.
So I went on the train with this thing, okay? So I felt very safe because it's a weapon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing? This is a piece of a 417 Donovan. It's the number one cylinder. This run was in 2004 for High Speed Motorsports, the team I race with now. And it was the first 5-second run that the team had ever run. And it also got me into the 250 mile an hour club with a 251 mile an hour. It's got the dash plaque on it from the Hot Rod Reunion. And it's got one of the rods. Look at how oblong the rod hole is.
Yep.
And the entire team signed it. and they gave this to me to commemorate killing the record or getting in the fives for the team. And yeah, so this is my favorite thing.
So that's part of a Donovan 417.
Yes.
That is way cool.
It's the number one cylinder.
You know, Del Worsham brought some stuff that's great. Jack Beckman, Ron Capps, and you know, Robert Height did too, and so did Corey McLenathan. But I think you win.
It's so bitchin'. When I found out, they said, hey, you got a trophy. And I said, a trophy? What are you talking about? And they hand me this. And I just, and it was still oily when they handed it to me. I went, are you kidding me? That is amazing.
That is great. And we have some photographs to show you from the files here. So you could talk us through these photographs. And they go way back. Tell us about some of these.
So that is my top alcohol dragster. That's probably 1989. That is the, let's see. That's a car that I ran 615 in when the record was a 621.
Wow.
And
it's a good looking car.
It's okay. Yeah, and it's okay. You know, my dad and I, my dad built the chassis. I built the body on it. It's a little short. You know, I used to tire shake like a mofo. And, but yeah, I loved that car. It was great.
Our next picture. Wow, look at that. That looks like the back of the alcohol dragster right there.
It is. I'm setting the clutch on it. I'm wearing a t-shirt with my face on it, which is hilarious.
It's
hilarious.
A great photo.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's the Roadster.
Yeah, that's the Roadster, and that's me in there. There were other drivers to that before I turned 16. But yep, so this Roadster was the world's quickest and fastest street legal hot rod, and dominated the nostalgia class called Super Street, which was supposed to be street legal hot rods. We built a race car and made it street legal. And the funny thing about this car is it was so light that they passed a rule that you had to be 2,400 pounds. So we had to bolt like 500 pounds on the car, right?
Wow.
And then at the races, they told us that it had to be permanent weight. And there was no welder around. So we had the battery pack to the alcohol dragster in the race car, and we actually welded the nuts with jumper cables. Like, so we had jumper cables on the batteries and just with the handle of the jumper cable and welded the nuts, just so there's a little bead on there. And they're like, that's not welded. And my dad handed him a 9/16 wrench. He said, you take it off,
wow.
Right?
I love the fuel injection stacks.
Yeah, that's the old Crower injectors.
Awesome.
Looks like, I used to call them the popcorn maker. That is my first B. Econo dragster.
Got a blower on it, though.
Huh? Yeah. Well, that's when we put a blown 454 in it with a power glide and got my alcohol dragster license.
So that was the comp car that kind of transitioned to the alcohol car.
Yeah. Yeah. That blower. Okay. Woo! That's me adjusting the valves on the Roadster.
Look how happy you are.
Yeah. Well, I'm doing what I love.
Exactly.
Look at the perm.
Yeah, I haven't made one comment about your hairstyle, by the way. You noticed that.
Yeah.
I've been good about that.
That's so great. I've got the S&S Automotive, you know, Santos shirt
Santos,
on.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Rick Santos mm-hmm. and George.
Northern California represent.
Pretty awesome. Now, next up is our, I call this the lightning round. So
okay.
I gave you the idea earlier, so we can go through this rather quickly. All right, snake or mongoose?
Snake.
Big Daddy or Shirley?
Big Daddy.
Roland Leong or the Ace?
Roland Leong.
He tuned your car, so
yeah.
You're pretty close to Roland.
Yeah.
Okay, funny car or top fuel? Nostalgia funny car or double A fuel dragster?
Oh, top fuel.
All right.
Hands down.
A March meet win or a championship win?
Oof.
Gotcha.
Oh, yeah. The March meet win was the most emotional, but it also was my first top fuel win. But the championship, I don't know. It's a push.
It's a push.
Man.
It's okay.
Yeah, it's a push.
All right. Your favorite top fuel car of all time, not your car, but a car that you really loved growing up, or some car that you still think about. You know.
So I was really into Gary Beck and Larry Miner with their car that they won the championship in.
The all blue car.
The all blue car, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I could not get enough of that car. I waited for National Dragster every Monday so that I could read it before Dad got home, so I could, like, spoiler alert for him.
So you were stalking Gary Beck?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay. All right.
I'm going to tell you a Gary Beck story. Can I tell you a Gary
Beck
story?
Yeah, make it quick.
So when I met him, finally, it was before I started driving these. So it was like 2002. And somebody else told him, she's trying to get a ride in one of these things. And he said, do you want to drive one? And I'm like, with all due respect, sir, I am going to drive one.
And you did.
I did.
And you're a champion like him.
I know. It's crazy.
It's pretty awesome. Now, this answer is pretty obvious. Your favorite car that you've driven. The one you currently drive?
Of course. Okay. Yeah.
What's the toughest car you've ever driven? The one that gave you fits?
The toughest car I've ever driven.
Was it one of the funny cars?
No, those weren't that hard. I mean, I don't know. I mean, there's a few that were just, you know, I don't want to call anybody out.
Okay. I respect that. All right, Bakersfield or Fremont?
Oh, God, that's tough. Fremont. I would go to Fremont more. Fremont.
Okay. Your biggest win?
Oh, the March meet, 2017.
Your greatest single run would be the 549, or is there one other one that stands out?
My 615 in an alcohol dragster.
Really?
When I was a kid. Yeah, just because it was so emotional, you know, and it broke the record, although they didn't give it to us. It wasn't a sanctioned event, but still, like, that was... There was so much to get the car built and, you know, like financially to be able to build it. And then to come out, it was on the first full pass ever that we ran. And we ran a 615. And I will never forget that day.
Your toughest opponent?
My toughest opponent, it's got to be Adam Sorokin. Yeah, he's a... You know, he's such a good driver, and you know, his car's got a little bit of a short fuse these days. And if it wasn't, man, you know... He's tough.
Who would be your favorite opponent to race?
My favorite opponent, God, I wish I could have like raced against Art Chrisman. You know?
There you go.
That was a long time ago, but.
Well, that's kind of that's the segue to my next little part of our little interview story. And that's, I like to call it drag racing time machine. So if you can go back to any part of drag racing history, a specific mm-hmm. event, a specific race, a moment, what would it be and why?
It'd have to be the Smokers era, you know, at Famoso. It would have to be one of those. I mean, I would love to have seen, like I just mentioned Art Chrisman, but I'd love to see him win the first one. But then to watch Mike Sorokin win, like, the most amazing one, that would have been great to be there, yeah.
Well, Mandy, you've been a great guest, and good luck.
Thank you.
Close out the championship season, and we'll see you there. Can't wait.
Yeah, we'll come out to the Hot Rod Reunion. You know, it's a blast, and we're doing it for Tom, right? We're going there with the intent to win that thing, not just a place.
Let's do it for Tom.
We're doing it for Tom.